We are honored to invite Sri M. Venkaiah Naidu ji, Honorable Vice President of India, to address the gathering.
Honorable Governor of Tamil Nadu, Sri Banwaral Purohit ji, Honorable Home Minister of India, Sri Amit Shah ji, Honorable Chief Minister, Sri Palaniswamy ji, Deputy Chief Minister, Sri Paneer Selvam ji, Honorable Minister for Information Broadcasting, who is the host, who is the organizer of this function, Sri Prakash Javadekar ji, and then the eminent personalities who are all there on the dais, and also the distinguished guests who have come from not only from Chennai, from also other parts of Tamil Nadu to this program, and my brothers and sisters, Indraya Nigalchikki Vandirikum Anevarikum Vanakkam. In the Nigalchiyal Ungudan Urai Aduvadil Nan Peru Magilchi Adegaran. You all know that I have special liking and love for this state of Tamil Nadu, because Tamil Nadu is part of India. And Tamil Nadu is a vibrant state. I have no hesitation to say. I can repeat it also. The land is fertile. The brains are fertile. And it has got a great history in the freedom movement, in the social reformist movement, and also in the protection of our culture, heritage and language. Everywhere, Tamil Nadu always used to be in the forefront. It is our duty, irrespective of this party or that party, we should all see to it that that leadership of the forward movement is always kept. My dear sisters and brothers, I am extremely happy to be admitted to you today, especially with Sri Amit Shah, the Honorable Home Minister, who has so graciously released this chronicle of my engagements over the last 2 years as the Vice President of India. I am thankful to Sri Prakash Javadekar, the Minister of Information Broadcasting, for bringing out such an attractive compilation. I am happy that Sri Banwaral Purohit ji, Honorable Governor of Tamil Nadu, he has consented to be here and also opted not to speak to give me more time to speak. Sri Edappadi K. Palaniswamy, Honorable Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, Sri O. Paneer Selvam, Honorable Deputy Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, and a galaxy of people here on the dais as well as in front of me, members of Parliament of all parties, very rarely this combination. You know, in Tamil Nadu, if X is there, then Y will not go that side. But today you have DMK, you have ADMK, you have PMK, and you also have the other parties also. Communist Party, my friend Rangarajan is here. Another friend was expected, Raja. I don't know what has happened. But Raja, once he becomes Raja, now from Rajya Sabha he has come to party. So he must be busy with the Praja after being Raja for some time. That's why he could not come here. And the MPs of Andhra Pradesh also, some of them have come here. I'm very happy. It's a privilege for me to be on the dais of galaxy of the illuminaries like Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, whom I revere, admire, because he's the father of the green revolution of the country. In spite of his health, you have seen, even at this stage also, he always thinks, talks and writes about agriculture, which is our basic culture. Dr. Kasturi Rangan, former director of ISRO and one of the famous scientists, and also who happened to be the chairman of the committee to draft the new education policy, is admitted here. He's also a very knowledgeable person. And then, see, Thiru Guru Murthy ji, Guru. He's really a guru to many. Now, as a vice president, if I say he's my guru, then members may go to him tomorrow onwards and start doing something. My people always tell me, sir, now you are vice president, you have to be careful with your this thing. But Guru, I can tell you, is so knowledgeable on every issue, on every aspect. He has a definite thinking. He has got clarity. And then he always used to give proper advice whenever it is sought. And Dr. Pratap C. Reddy, the pioneering founder of India's first corporate chain of hospitals. Sri Dr. G. Viswanathanji, founder and chancellor of VIT and also chairman of the educational group. Sri Pullela Gopichand, chief national coach of the Indian badminton team. We are missing today one of the great legal luminaries who was supposed to be here, even at this age of 90 plus. He has agreed to come, but he telephoned to me saying that the Ayodhya case is being heard by the Supreme Court on day-to-day basis. So coming here and again going back the same day, and also his preoccupation, he has excused himself and convey his best wishes to me. And I find that such a great man of knowledge, Sri Parasaran, I don't think there is any parallel to him after Nani Falkiwala. If I have to name one person in the legal fraternity, the first name comes to my mind is Sri Parasaran. That also from this place. That's why I said about Tamil Nadu. Whether it is doctors, whether it is tractor running farmers, or it is actors, Tamil Nadu is top. And today, out of affection for me, not because of politics, I am no more in politics. I do not belong to Amit Shah's party now, no more. I was in politics, but I retired from politics, but not tired from public life. That's why I am here. Because of love and affection for me, Sri Rajinikanth ji, you initially told me he has a shooting, but God has told him, I am going to rain there, you can go. So, he could make it to join this function. I wanted this function to be held in Chennai because I am the vice president of the country. Country do not mean Delhi alone. The country includes all. So south, north, east, west. So I want to set up an example to have function in this southern part of the country. And I also want to have a function in different manner. Last time the function was attended by the Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Bhai Modi, former Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh, Law Minister, Minister of the Finance, my friend, Sri Arun Jaitley, and then Srimati Sushma Swaraj, and then Sumitra Mahajan Speaker, and also opposition leaders and all. This time I would have had it in Delhi. Naturally, if the Vice President wants some function, anybody will mobilize. But I thought, no, we should go to other place. And secondly, we should have it in a different manner. And I should have this function in the company of galaxy of great people who are doing a great job in various public activities. That is the purpose of holding this and troubling all these seniors for this function and having this many number of speeches also. I have learned a lot from each one of these Dayans and continue to learn new things whenever I meet and interact with them, because I am of the conviction people in public life must always be students to know something more. Learn before you start. Learn. Even after you learn also, still continue to learn. This is the way forward. Learning is a continuous process because the world is advancing. We are a global village now. Things are happening. New technology, new ideas, new innovation, out-of-box ideas. Science is making improvements. So new things will come out. And you have opened up. And you are living in an era of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. So everything is competition now. So you have to go on learning. That's the purpose of calling all these great learned people here to this function. My dear friends, I must tell you the truth, because Amit Shah spoke about some truth about me when I was in party. I should also tell all of you, share the truth in front of Amit Shah ji. He also has a role in that. I never wanted to become vice president. Let me be very clear. Not that I am against vice president. As Guru was telling, from childhood, from my 13th year, I have been busy in public life, meeting people, greeting people, talking with people, walking with the people, spending time with the people, eating with the people, sleeping along with the people. That has been my habit. And I used to enjoy it. I have covered maximum area in the country, more than 600 districts I have covered right from my student days. And the party to which I belonged at the time and the organization, they gave me support. Like that, I went around number of districts, number of, in every state, some of the districts I might have covered 10 times. I have learned, so by going around, And then I was enjoying it. People used to say, sir, are you not getting tired? I said, no, I enjoy. More programs means more happiness. But they should be disciplined, systematic. That is the only thing which can trouble me and which can make me restive also. So that way I was enjoying it. So then I told Prime Minister Narendra Bhai Modi, I think it was my mistake not to tell Amit Bhai, I don't know what you would have done it also. I told Prime Minister Narendra Bhai, I want to set an example like Sri Nanaji Deshmukh. So by the time I become 70, I want you to come back as the Prime Minister again in 2019. And after you come back as the Prime Minister, after joining the government, I would like to quit the government and follow Nanaji Deshmukh and go for constructive work, Rachanatma Karyakram. I wanted to spend that. I told him in the beginning. I told him in 2016, 2017. Each time I was trying to tell, Prime Minister used to tell me, Venkaya ji, 2019 hai na, abhi samay hai. You are talking of 2019 na, time is there. Like that, he just... And I told my wife also that 2019, after election, we must be ready to leave Delhi and go to our own gali. And then do the social work, which we have already started, Swarna Bharat. My daughter and other friends are all working in that. Advani ji inaugurated, Narendra Bhai was there. So many people, some of you, even Swaminathan ji was there, Kasturi Rangan ji was there. Many people have visited that also. So I wanted to spread that movement, not in that name, across the country and make an example to that we can leave ministership also. Told my wife, get ready and see that granddaughter is put in some other institution after 19th and be prepared. She said her heart always lives in village. She was never comfortable in Delhi. So she was also happy within heart of hearts and waiting for that. I gave the date also, 2020, January 12th. Because January 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, Sankranti. They are very pious days. So always I used to be at home. I said by that time, pack up and then back up to our place. That is the idea. So I was planning on that count and I was enjoying that I'm going to do like that. Because leaving union ministry, leaving parliament, and then doing social work, definitely people will be happy. Some people may not be happy because they'll be happy only if I'm minister, then something can happen to the state and to the country and to the society in a better manner. That may be thinking of the people also. Some people thought on those lines and I became vice president also. I was thinking in a different manner. So, but it did not. And this did not happen. Just before the election, I was reminding Amit Bhai, by time Orek, you have to finalize the candidate. He said, we are discussing. In normal term, I was telling you must finalize the candidate because I always used to think about organization, Sanghatan. That was my life and that was my love. So then he said, I'm in touch with the Prime Minister, he's also applying. Then one day he told me, what should be the criteria, some ideas. So then I said, the Vice President should be from South, preferably because already President is there. And preferably South, Vice President must be farmer, agriculturist, because we have a person from downtrodden sections as the President of India, and then a farmer as Vice President also will be helpful. Then third one is somebody who has got capacity and commitment. They said, okay. Then they started discussing and all. Just one day before, Amit Bhai came to me and told me, Prime Minister is going to speak to you. I said, okay. Then I gave them some names also. I don't want to reveal those names now because I don't recognize. Those people will be disappointed. And then I met the Prime Minister. Prime Minister said, whatever you have said, correct. We also thought on those lines. But there's nobody who can be suitable as per those criteria. So party is meeting today evening, parliamentary board, we will discuss and then finalize. I got some doubt, not about me, but what is happening, etc. So in the evening parliamentary board, President Amit Bhai said, this is discussion and at the end of the discussion, now everybody says that it will be appropriate to have Venkaya ji. So his name is now liked by all. I talked to all people. Everybody said he is the most suitable man and all. I never expected that. I was in tears. Not because I'm losing that ministership anyway, I'm going to leave. Because at the time I was taken by emotion for the simple reason I am son of a farmer. I come from a very humble background. None in my family were in politics. None were much educated also. Of course, saying now, nowadays you say so-and-so's family, grandson of so-and-so, son of so-and-so, daughter of so-and-so, all these things are there, na? But I did not have any of that. Simply, my qualification is I joined the movement at a very young age, ABVP, RSS, and then was a grassroots level worker. And then, step by step, the party has made me everything in my life except the one that is the Prime Minister for which I am not suitable. I know that. I know very much. I know very much, very clear that what are my capacities and calibers. So, that tomorrow onwards, if I become Vice President, I can't go to BJP party office. I can't meet regular BJP workers. What will happen to this movement? That was the worry in my mind. Then I was in tears. Then every one of them, they said, no, 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 we are all there. We'll continue the mission, this, that, and all. It happened. The only disappointment for me is that I could not have my wish fulfilled. Amit Shah must be having some role in that. I don't know, whatever it is. The president, he has to take the responsibility. The president one has to take the responsibility. Friends, and then after becoming this thing, Sushma Swaraj told me from Venkaya ji, you will be missing two important things which are dearer to you from tomorrow. Everybody asked, in the meeting itself, everybody said, what are the two? One is the tour, travel. Second is media, meeting people and media. These are the two favorite things according to Sushmaji. Then you will be missing. Then the other man, Arun Jaitley, the other friend, he said, don't worry. No, he will be having a special plane. He can go anywhere, wherever you want. And secondly, he also will be having a television channel also. So then they were started discussing like that. Prime Minister cut them short and told, you don't worry. Venkayaji knows how to convert every institution dynamic. And he knows how to move on. Don't worry on that count. Like that he said. But after becoming Vice President, they briefed me all these protocols, this, that and all. Vice President will come on time, then come on to dais. Others should be there on the dais beforehand. Public should be seated 15 minutes before. All these things, and then there will be security check, this, that, and all. Then Vice comes on the ass, then Janaganamana, then speeches, then again Janaganamana, then Vice President goes, you have to be in your seat. Then they briefed me. I said, then what is the fun of going to the meeting? You can as address the meeting through video conference if you are not. So then slowly I started applying my mind, and I have decided to bring in some changes. And I have decided that I don't want to do politics. The day when it was decided, 7 o'clock, when Amit Bhai has announced this, I politely resigned from the party, resigned from Rajya Sabha, and then said goodbye to these people and went home. Of course, with a very heavy heart, because the party which has given me everything, an ordinary person becoming Vice President of India, becoming ruling party president, when I joined that party, the party was not popular. People used to say, North Indian party, yeh toh Sakahari party, Brahmin Baniya party. Yeh kabhi satta mein aayega nahi, this will never come to power. People used to tell me, my own area people, this will never come into power and all. So I did not join the party to come to power alone. I had some conviction at that time. So joined. So, but and then whenever Atal Bihari Vajpayee, I should share that also with you people. Whenever Vajpayee used to come to my place, I used to announce through mic. Sitting on a jetka. Jetka is tanga. What do you call here? Tanga, no? Not rickshaw. Horse driven. This thing. Gurub Bandi, we call it this. So, and then make announcement. Today evening, Atal Bihari Vajpayee is coming to Nellur. At 6 o'clock, there is a public meeting in Cooperative Central Bank grounds. Please come to the meeting and make it successful. I used to announce it in Telugu, of course, not in English. Because people know only Telugu, not English. I used to make announcement. I never imagined that boy who made announcement of Vajpayee arrival And we used to write about Vajpayee on walls. Walls. I was student leader, but I used to write on walls about the party. Never expected the boy who made announcement about arrival of Atal Bihari Vajpayee will become president of the ruling party one day and preside over the party, sitting between Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Advani. That is the honor the party has given to me, to a grassroots level worker. Grassroots level worker. And then in president, before that general secretary, before that spokesperson, before that state president, before that state general secretary, before that MLA, before that leader in assembly, before that even spokesperson of the party, then rural development minister, and then urban development minister, then information broadcasting, then parliament affairs minister. All these things have been given to me. I never expected this. So that's why I was in emotion and tears. The only reason I can tell you the lesson is, please have commitment. Continue. You can reach heights. That is the example of not only me, the example of the President of India, the example of the Prime Minister of India, Narendra Bhai Modi, also comes from a very humble background. That is the example of Amit Bhai Shah, comes from a very humble background. So one must have conviction, and one must have capacity, caliber, and conduct, and must have some patience. That is the lesson I have learned, and I hope people understand this. When I started discussing, then five areas we have decided. One, visit all the universities, 900 universities. Second, visit all the research centers. Third, visit all the technology headquarters, IITs, IIITs, IES, IESR, agriculture institutes, defense institutes. And third, reach out to farmers in a big way. Go to the farmers and go to Krishi Vijnana Kendra, go to research centers, go to universities, agriculture universities, interact with scientists. Then the next one is go to cultural bodies, dance, music, literature, poetry, language, and other cultural activities. Attend those programs. And then public bodies like CAA, FICCI, ASSOCHAM, industry bodies, agriculture bodies, Rotary Club, Lions Club. Many organizations are there in this country. Doctors are there, chartered accountants are there, cinema people are there, a lot of drama and artists are there. Interact with them to the extent possible. These five areas, I gave the chart to my people and asked them to prepare program, and then we'll be going around. I asked, are there any restriction on the movement? They said, sir, you have to go. You can't go by regular flight. Regular flight. You have to go by special flight. Not by special flight, private. You have to go by Air Force flight. Then you have to go. Then there will be 25 people accompanying you. And then something like that, they said. I was initially disappointed about all this. Why I should go by Air Force? Why can't I go by regular flight and all? They said, no, sir. Protocol do not, and also it's a question of security of the second highest constitutional authority and all. So we adjusted ourselves and then went around. I told my secretary, my secretary also is a very educated person, competent. Educated means in knowledge. Education is not for only employment for a degree. Education is for enhancement of knowledge. Education is for enlightenment. Education is for empowerment. And then, of course, employment also. That comes last. But that is coming first now to many people. So they prepare the programs accordingly. And then one, the moment people came to know the vice president is ready to come, then we have a request for another 5 years. If I have to fulfill the request of the people, I think the list is sufficient for another 5 years that way. We have been going around. And I said, call this as knowledge pilgrimage. The program is called as knowledge pilgrimage. Acquire knowledge. Land. That is what I am doing. And today, after 2 years, I thought I should present a chronicle of events of these 2 years to the people, because it's your duty, as part of your responsibility, report back to the people. In democracy, one has to report back to the people. In politics, they have to report back to the people and get their mandate also. Here, there is no question. As I told you, I am out of politics. I am not going to come back to politics. I am not going to contest the election also that way. That's very clear. I am very clear in my mind. I am very happy about it also. But public life is something beyond politics. And what is our wish? Our wish is to see that India becomes strong, stable, prosperous, inclusive growth. It should be in the top. I'm very happy this is happening. Recently, I've been to 19 countries wherever I went, my dear friends. India is being recognized and respected everywhere, thanks to the reforms of Narendra Modi ji and the government. and the initiative taken by earlier governments also, different state governments also. Now the world focuses on India. India is being recognized and respected. See, had it happened sometime back, about 370, what would have been the reaction of the world? Now world is sympathetic to India. They are appreciating your problems, thanks to the leadership and the initiative. So once upon a time, India was known as Visvaguru, Naranda, Takshasila, that Takshasila, which is out of India, and also Vikramasila, Ujjain. All these, you know, students used to come and then learn here. We have to regain that supremacy again, and we have to become strong and stable. We used to hear about Gupta's period, Krishnadevaraya period, where diamonds and gold used to be sold on the streets. That's the history, and Gupta's period is called as golden age. So India must attain there. And then where there's no poverty, where there's no unemployment, where there's no discrimination on the basis of caste or religion or region or gender. That is the India we want to see. Even after becoming vice president, that is my agenda. And that continues to be my ambition also. For that, in whatever manner I can do, go around, meet the people, see the work, pat them on their back, motivate them, and then if there are any problems, then tell it to Prime Minister, tell it to the ministers. Thanks to them that they are sympathetically hearing what I am saying, because I am getting feedback from the grassroots level and I have nothing to do with politics. Whenever I go and meet people, whenever I receive representation, I am getting back into government asking them, please consider this. Because power is not there with me now and I am not supposed to interfere in day-to-day administration also. This is what I am doing. That is the purpose of reporting back to you all people of these engagements and all. I am not going into those details and all, but I thought I should share these thoughts with the people of our country. There are so many exciting achievements and so many ambitious programs that are putting our country on a new and distinctly faster trajectory. The Prime Minister Modi's mantra, reform, perform and transform. Reform, new ideas, perform and then implement. And third is transform, transforming the nation. Nation means not the map, geographical map. Nation consists of 135 crore people. All these people, the Dalits, the downtrodden, the suppressed, the oppressed, the depressed people, the people sitting in the last line, not here in the auditorium, in the society, last line. And then they have to be uplifted. The poverty, 20% poverty even today, 18% people are 20% people are illiterate. 18 to 20 are poverty stricken. There are some areas where there is still gender discrimination. Women are being discriminated in certain areas, not everywhere. And there are areas where caste discrimination is there in certain areas. These are the challenges. And then, as I told you, competition is increasing. So we have to really prepare ourselves to meet these challenges, take care of these drawbacks and weaknesses. So I always go around people and then see the reaction and the change that is happening, and the change that is happening on account of the reforms program of the government and also the good work done by our scientists and agriculturists and others. 73rd year of independent India, a few days from now, August 15th, my thoughts go to the quality of our polity. The first thing is to ponder the current situation of our three state organs, legislature, executive and judiciary, and see how can we further strengthen these three pillars. The state legislatures and the parliament have an important policy-making role. They are supposed to make legislation for the betterment of the country, and people take up and deliberate on the issues of public importance and ensure accountability of the government of the day. While some legislative bodies are functioning well, in many others, there is certainly considerable room for improvement. This is number one observation and my suggestion. Legislatures must become more dynamic. They must function. They should not have disruption. There is a general perception that the quality of debates has been declining. Disruptions have become more common occurrence than before. Acrimony, emotional outbursts have tended to dominate proceedings. So I have been urging parliamentarians to refrain from such dysfunctional behavior. I have constantly reminded them of their duty and a unique opportunity to shape public discourse. I hope that all political parties will adopt a code of conduct for their legislators and contribute to policy making through informed discussions. Make their MPs, MLAs, public representatives behave in an ideal manner. This is my recommendation to the people and political parties across the country. Discuss, debate and decide, not disrupt. And I say, let the government propose Opposition oppose, let the house dispose. That should be done. There's no other way in democracy. There's no other way. This has to be understood. So we also need to elect, select and elect people on the basis of character, caliber, capacity and conduct. That is required. But unfortunately, some people are trying to replace these four by another four C's. What are those other? Character, caliber, capacity and conduct. Other four C's are caste, community, cash, and criminality. You know some people tried, succeeded to some extent. That should not be allowed at all. Then that means there is no meaning in democracy. You must go by the performance and the commitment they have given and the promise and performance they have made. This is one thing. Second thing is making law is only a part of the story. Implementing them is a more crucial aspect of governance. Designing programs, funding them, monitoring their implementation, and evaluating their outcome is the crux of the good governance. People should not only become prosperous, rich, they must also feel happy. Happiness is different from prosperity. Simple prosperity alone will not get you happiness. Peaceful atmosphere, no hatred, no division, broadly love and affection for each other, and loving the nature, living with the nature. That's why I say love and live with the nature. Nature, culture, together for a better future. We must have that attitude. It is not only a duty of government, but it's a duty of the people also to see that the nature is protected, then nature will protect you also. So like that, the quality of service delivery, this is third one. Second is policy implementation. Third is service delivery. Passing a good law, good debate, fine. Then trying to implement the program, fine. But delivery, the ultimate thing is delivery, reaching the people. Reaching the people, that is very important. So they need to pay more attention than what is being done today. How effectively are we able to deliver public services like water, sanitation, power, housing, transportation, education, health? How effectively we are able to provide support to farmers, youth, traders, entrepreneurs, and industrialists and different sections of society? This has to be seen. How efficiently we are building durable, world-class infrastructure like road, rail, air connectivity, rail connectivity, ecosystem for growth and development. This has to be seen. This is important. How swiftly and sustainably are we creating conditions for inclusive growth? Everybody should feel, I am also partner in this development. You know, development means only for few people, 5-star hotels, 7-star hotels, and then 4-way highway, 8 lines, then airport, new airport has come. All these things are there. But common man, they have minimum requirements. Those people also should feel that they are also taken into consideration, their aspirations also are being met. That's why we talk of inclusive growth. Inclusive growth is more important. We have to constantly reflect on these questions and find answers through honest evaluation. We have to act promptly and make our delivery system work better. While a lot of improvement has been made over the years, service delivery remains very often the big missing link in certain areas. Central government is doing its best. States are doing their best. And they must all do better than this. Because huge population, regional disparities, language problems, and also, as I told you, there are middlemen who will exploit the situation and all. So we have to improve the delivery system. That is more important. The fruits of development must reach everywhere. I'm glad that the reforms initiated by Honorable Prime Minister made a step in this direction. The many states, different, ruled by different parties, are also taking steps to see the delivery system is improved. There people should not be allowed to stand in line. Everything should be decided online. You need not stand in line. Standing in line, going to the office, meeting the person, greeting the person, shaking hand and doing something in between hand. There should not be any necessity at all. There should not be any necessity at all. Direct. Yesterday I was in Jharkhand. Jharkhand government introduced a new scheme of giving some support to agriculturists. So Prime Minister 6,000 rupees, state government amount of some 5,000 rupees per acre, up to 5 acres. The money, no need to go to any office. You have to register yourself. And then in your phone number, your account will come in your bank. And then money reaches you. And then women were there yesterday. There were 8,000 people in Ranchi. They were asked, raise your cell phone. Cell phone is given free by the state government. And then raise your phone and see whether you have got the amount or not. They made some lot of exercise. The people are showing this. They were seeing the phone and then there is happiness. Money directly reaching them. That is required. The compensation, the insurance, the pension, the scholarship, And all the entertainment should reach the people directly. This should be our endeavor. That already PM has made that this Janathana, Aadhaar, Mobile, and also the DBT, Direct Benefit Transfer. This should be strengthened further. You can have whatever name you want. I don't want to get into that. But delivery is more important. Then people also should be made to participate in the governance. Because people feel, this is all duty of the government. We need not do anything. Everything will be done by the government. Sab kaam sarkar karega. Hum bekar baithe se chalega. Aisa nahi chalega. We should also do our duty. This Swachh Bharat program, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, and then tree plantation, water, river connectivity. Sadhguru has taken a campaign for river connectivity and all. Many such things are there. Unless people cooperate, you cannot operate properly. Even the yoga. Yoga should become a people's movement. Some people feel this is a Modi's. No, yoga is not for Modi. It is for your body. You have to understand that. You have to understand that and then take up such things. And funds and functions, functionaries, three Fs, should be decentralized to the municipal bodies and panchayat raj. I'm happy 14th Finance Commission has given some good amount, but that's not sufficient. We must move on. This legislation was passed in during Rajiv Gandhi days. 73 and 74th constitutional amendment of devolution of powers and funds and functions. Some of the states are yet to transfer those 29 subjects. So we must make progress on that. On this occasion of 2 years, this is another point I want to make. Third, the law, judiciary. The judiciary, not only legislature and executive, but judiciary also must be more responsive. Judicial process must become more people-friendly. The law enforcement machinery and the justice dispensing structure must be more accessible, credible, equitable, and transparently even-handed. There's a lot of ground we have to cover in this regard. The Chief Justice of India has recently talked about heavy pendency of cases in various courts. Apparently, there are nearly 60,000 cases pending in the Supreme Court. Nearly 44 lakh cases pending in high courts. We need to take action to reduce this heavy pendency. Justice delayed, as often said, is justice denied. We have been hearing this. What is it we are able to do? I'm happy. Recently, the government took initiative and Parliament passed a legislation enhancing 10% of the strength of the Supreme Court. But I feel it should increase further. And I would like to suggest some measures to streamline and make justice delivery more effective. I have been emphasizing the urgency to decide certain categories of cases in a time-bound and like election petition. I can tell you one of the election petitions in Tamil Nadu, which is very popular. Petition was filed in 2009. 14, election is over. 19, election is over. Still, petition is not disposed. I'm just one example I'm giving because I'm in the state. Many examples are there. What is the meaning of a petition? First election over, second election over. Then what are you doing? We have to take a decision. That's one. Election petitions. Second, criminal cases against MPs and MLAs. Is it a shame that if a person is accused of a criminal case and is under a cloud of suspicion and the court do not clear it at the earliest because of maybe genuine reasons, then it's a sad commentary on our system. And then it has been found election petitions, criminal cases and disqualification proceedings under anti-defection law are not decided even for the entire tenure of the legislators, defeating the very purpose of these laws. In cases involving disqualification of members of the legislature who change party, the chairperson of the legislative bodies must expeditiously take a decision. Here also, the anti-defection law is not implemented in letter and spirit because of the inaction of the speakers or chairman. The legislature continued, one legislator goes from one party to another party and there become minister also. Who are contesting in one party ticket, going to the other party, then becoming minister, still the case is pending, not yet heard. I'm not binding out to any state. Many, many examples are there. And you also know the examples. I need not tell. Should we allow that such a situation? This kind of travesty of justice should not be tolerated. Any delays in these cases erode public confidence in the judicial and legislative bodies. When a petition came before me of the disqualification, I decided it within 2 days and then said any petition should be disposed of within 3 months. Not 10 years, 15 years, or one term, two terms and all. I would suggest that we should have special judicial tribunals which will decide the cases with a reasonable time of, let us say, 6 months or at the most 1 year. I would also suggest to revisit the 10th schedule of the Constitution containing anti-defection provisions to ensure a time-bound disposal of such cases and make it more effective by plugging loopholes with regard to merger, with regard to disqualification, with regard to split. There is some grey areas. So we must revisit the 10th schedule. MPs are also sitting here. Media is there across the country. I know that many people will be watching this also. We should discuss this and come to some conclusions. I am not saying this way or that way. As a vice president, as a chairman of Rajya Sabha, as a person who has got experience of 42 years in public life, these are the important criminal cases, one, election petitions, two, and then anti-defection, three, and then taking care of the 10th schedule. These are all urgent reforms that are required to be taken. We need to bring judicial system closer to the people. Expanding the Supreme Court bench and having separate benches in different regions and at least one in Chennai on trial basis has been suggested by Parliamentary Standing Committee on Law and Justice. I tend to agree with the recommendation. I think it is high time we had more benches because in a country like vast like India, the litigants have to travel long distance and spend a huge amount of money and energy going to Delhi, charge, staying there, charge, getting a lawyer who can appear before the Supreme Court, that also is very costly. Why should such small cases go to up to Delhi? Why not we have zone benches? That has been recommended by a standing committee of the parliament. It is high time the Supreme Court and government applies their minds seriously to this and have different benches. I am not saying Chennai because I am in Chennai today and all. That recommendation is to have one bench in south, one bench in east, one bench in west and all. To start with, I suggested, that's why let us start with Chennai and all. We have enough advocates here. They are going to Delhi to appear. They can be here only and happily appear also. That also will be useful, practical also. We have enough knowledgeable people. I think it's high time that more benches are created to reduce the huge pendency and expense. Third one is that it is heartening that the government have enhanced the number of judges in the Supreme Court by 10%, but I'm afraid it will still be inadequate. A number of civil and criminal cases have been pending over 25 years. Recently, some retired judges told me, Supreme Court judge, the other day before my retirement, I heard a case which is 30 years old. I said, what case? Criminal case. 30 years back, somebody has committed criminality. What will be his age now? How long he has been in jail if he has not got bail? Then what is the effect of your judgment at all? So it is again a sad commentary on our system. Movements of India is here, fortunately. I hope he will also be applying his mind. This makes me think that we need not only to expand the Supreme Court, but also divide the work into constitutional division, number of legal divisions of the court or court of appeal. As the law commission has suggested, I would like the Supreme Court to have two divisions to start with, one dealing with the constitutional matters and another with appeals. This suggestion merits serious consideration and decision by the Supreme Court as well as by the government, because it would enable the Supreme Court to devote more time to constitutional issues and make it more accessible to common people. Very important issue. This has to be kept in mind. The suggestion of the Chief Justice of India to raise the retirement age of High Court judges and make tenure appointments to clear the backlog seems to be a pragmatic solution to the current context. If the government has got alternative ideas, if the parliament can think about alternative ideas also, how to have early disposal, quick disposal of the cases at the Supreme Court level, that has to be thought of. Then procedure for appointment of judges, another important thing. I know I am taking an issue which is very sensitive. Judges used to be appointed by some system. Later, the parliament in its collective wisdom has decided it should not be in the hands of this or that. It should be through National Judicial Appointment Commission. The entire parliament discussed it and unanimously almost passed the legislation. The Supreme Court has struck down and said, no, this is not good. Collegium system is good. After that, in the collegium system, some judges held a press conference. They found fault with their colleagues. So what is the remedy? So you must understand what are the practical problems and come with some idea where there is a broad consensus to have a system which is transparent, which is clean, and where there is no scope for any allegation. So we have to revisit and a credible, transparent process institution which will steer clear of avoidable controversies. This should be taken care at the earliest. The collegium system has been not been without certain drawbacks. The appointment of judges need to be done through a process which inspires confidence and credibility. The procedures must be simplified and proceedings should be by and large conducted in the language understood by common people. This is another point. Why should the advocate argue in English in Chennai court? The litigants, they don't know. They don't know what their advocate is arguing. Someone told me, sir, if they come to know, then they will value that advocate. I don't think that is the reason. I don't think that is the reason. People's language should be used in courts. In the high courts, every state must have. In Gujarat, Gujarati. In Tamil Nadu, Tamil. In Telugu, Andhra Pradesh, Telugu, like that. It should be promoted. And slowly, change. People will say, you know, it's difficult to translate and all. Now you have such an improvement of Google. Everything is there. Automatically, the other day I saw one artificial intelligence, one lady is standing like this. And then suddenly, the lady moves on. The original lady is here. The figure moves on. Hologram. And then starts speaking in Japanese. Japanese language. This lady, English. The other lady who has gone out of her body, she is speaking in Japanese. Automatically. They call it as artificial intelligence. If that is the situation, I don't think it will take much time. We are trying now in Supreme, in our parliament also. Members can speak in any of the 22 languages. Some of our MPs from Tamil Nadu, they are speaking in Tamil. There is this arrangement for translation. Initially, there may be some problems, but we will improve the system. So this is another important suggestion. These suggestions are for Supreme Court and for parliament and to the government. I am only giving suggestions as the vice president and as the chairman of Rajya Sabha. What is required is demystification of the process. It is generally noticed that an efficient, transparent, accessible and affordable judicial system is key touchstone of good governance, which can improve the ease of doing business as well as ease of living. My dear sisters and brothers, in order to three pillars of our polity, we have the fourth estate, the media, which plays an important role in shaping public discourse, enhancing accountability of the government and providing news and views on various events around the world. A free and vibrant media keeps democracy alive and can enrich the quality of life of people through information, education, entertainment, and insightful analysis. The technological advancement in recent years have brought unprecedented change in the media landscape. Social media, along with traditional press and TV, are having a profound influence on our lives and lifestyles, on our work and relationship. Like everything else in life, this transformation has the good, bad, and the ugly. You are seeing what is happening in the electronic media in some instances, what is happening in print media in some instances, what is happening in the social media also. Information is very important in this advancement of the civilization and development. Information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. If your information is with confirmation, it is more than an ammunition to fight against corruption, injustice, exploitation. All these things, you have to have correct information. The media should see to it that they provide correct information. And there is another problem that has come in the recent days. They combine news and views. News is separate. Views should be separate. Views should be left to editorial page. Or if that is not sufficient, you can have one more page also to add your views, your ideas, your all these things. But the news should be news. But nowadays, no, we have so many channels making news, breaking news, good news, bad news. Nahi to khud unka news, ek dusri ke khilaf news. आज तक कल तक सीधी बात उल्टी बात कितना बात है याद रखना भी मुश्किल है. एंड दे सेस ओ सर देन इमीडिएटली दे विल गो टू अमित शाह, दे विल गो टू प्रकाश जावड़ेकर, सर दिस इज द हेडलाइन. एंड दे मस्ट बी एबल टू से योर हेडलाइन इज नॉट गोइंग टू बी डेडलाइन फॉर मी, डोंट वरी, आई हैव माय ओन लाइन. वन मस्ट हैव दैट मस्ट करेज ना, दैट मच इन्फॉर्मेशन एंड कॉन्फिडेंस. द मीडिया यस शुड गिव द न्यूज एंड लीव इट द जजमेंट टू द पीपल. That should be the order of the day. And they must have a self-code of conduct to start with. Like the print media, there is a Press Council of India. For electronic media also, some such thing should come. And I think some beginning has been made. And it should be improved further to have some sort of accountability. Otherwise, you are seeing nowadays promoting hatred, division, discontentment. Media should be a dispassionate watchdog, an honest messenger, a friendly advisor, and a wholesome entertainer. This is the ideal we must aim to achieve. Media should also, like other organs of the governance, be more accountable for the authenticity and objective of the content. Media should also be the catalyst of a positive change and voice of the voiceless. It should combine information with confirmation that is considered to be more powerful than ammunition. It should question and seek answers and present the agreed truths in such a manner that social transformation occurs in the positive direction. It should help build public awareness and motivate people to join societal movements for cleanliness, health, hygiene, and education. I have dwelt on, at length on the foundation of our governance system. We are proud inheritors of an ancient civilization that had an excellent governance system based on sound theoretical and philosophical basis. We have to rebuild this edifice on new solid foundations. In 1947, we have struggled hard through 72 years to shape India as a vibrant democracy. We have done reasonably well. My various governments have done their best. There may be degrees of difference with regard to speed, with regard to, but development has taken place in the country. But this is not a movement to be complacent. World is moving faster. We must also move faster. And aspirations, 65% of the Indian population is below 35 years. They are very aspirational. Earlier, people used to go 50 years to a party, 40 years to a party. Now, after 5 years, people are asking, what you have said, what you have done. Expectations are very high. So we have to always be on charayaveti, charayaveti, like our ancient sages who have exhorted us. We must move on, move forward. We should focus on the 5 Ds I have already mentioned. Discuss, debate, decide. Then decentralize and deliver. This can transform the quality of our life, of our polity. Please take note. As we have excellent set of circumstances to transform our country, we are a young and aspirational India, and we have untapped demographic dividend, a fundamentally sound economy that is growing faster than most of the other countries, a pool of front-ranking individuals, and a strong leadership at all levels. If we can combine our collective competence for a common good, we can easily achieve mission we have set for ourselves. We cannot be only $5 trillion economy, but also a more vibrant democracy based on our civilizational values of tolerance, inclusion, and harmony. We should tap into our enormous resources for both human and material. We should incorporate values and ethics into education system. Very important. The new recommendations made by committee, they consist this part also. Earlier during my school days, I remember, we used to have a moral science class. Now only science, morals have gone. We used to have a craft class. We used to have a gardening class. And we used to have physical training compulsory. No physical training now. Because schools are run in multi-storied buildings. We must revisit. And then half the time in the classroom, remaining time on the ground or in the field. That should be the approach in the coming days as far as education is concerned. We should preserve the best aspects of our rich cultural heritage. And India has a rich linguistic diversity and literary heritage. I have been repeatedly suggesting children should have an opportunity to study in their mother tongue at least up to primary stage. This will enable Indian languages to be preserved and children will strengthen their foundation and cognitive abilities. I am not against other languages. You must learn English also. But first you must learn mother tongue. As I say everywhere, I have made a principle to say, everybody should remember mother, motherland, mother tongue. Mother tongue is like your eyesight. If you know mother tongue, that means your eyes are working. The eyes are like mother tongue. Spectacles are like other language. If you have eyesight, then if you have these spectacles, it will improve your sight and also you can use your foresight. But if you don't have even sight, blind, you know, even if you wear Ray-Ban glasses also, nothing is visible. So have foundation in Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayali, Marathi, Punjabi, Assami, Urdu, whatever, Tulu, Bhojpuri, any language of your choice, because bhasha or bhavana ek saath chalta hai. So no language should be opposed. I am in Chennai. I know I am talking before my colleagues. No language should be opposed. So my simple principle is no imposition, no opposition. That is my supposition and proposition. That should be the position of the government. Why should we oppose any language? But no language should be thrust forcefully. And children do not have the facility. They were writing language, postal this thing in Tamil. They forced it to other language. So we all discussed together. And then I called the minister. Minister also was kind enough to cancel the exam. And again, they are going to reconduct the exam. We should do it. But at the same time, if you don't learn other languages, you will be deprived. You will not be able to stand competition. Today, I have been able to come up to this level because I picked up some other language other than my mother tongue also. Learn English. It's an international language. No problem at all. But first, promote your mother tongue. At home, speak in your mother tongue. With your mother, brother, sister, and in the street and surroundings, speak in mother tongue. But the problem is not with the students. The problem is the parents, old parents. They say, Babu, say, mummy, daddy. Why this mummy, daddy, bidi, jadi? Why don't you say, ma, amma? am not talking of Jayakumar Samma or Palani Swami Samma. Palani Swami is having Amma even now also in his pocket. That is their faith. We should not have any objection for that. Either Amma or Aya, that is your choice, is your personal. You are Tamil Nadu has the advantage of having Amma also, Aya also. Both are very eminent people. Choice is people. But question is Amma. And you say like that, it comes from the heart. You say Mummy, it comes from here. So that is the difference. So please promote mother tongue, all state, and give opportunity to others also. People of other language. The other day there was an interesting question or discussion in the parliament saying that in other states also Tamil schools should be allowed. Yes. But in your state also other language schools also should be allowed. That should be understood. So this is a given talk. People are now the country, people are moving around. A lot of people are there, even here. But you must make a rule for administration. The administration, the local language knowledge is must. That mandate has to be there. Everybody who is there in service in Tamil Nadu, they should learn Tamil. Definitely, that should be. Even if you are a Telugu man or a Kannadiga or Marathi and all, you have to learn. Because if you want to do job and still you don't want to learn the local language, you cannot do justice. So this sort of approach has to be there. As we shape our future, we must certainly focus on making agriculture. The last point, the central and state government must work together to provide inputs, implements, insurance, infrastructure, credit warehousing and marketing in an integrated manner, diversification of crops, supplementation of farmers' incomes through activities like dairy, poultry, agroforestry and aquaculture are all value addition. I appeal to all of you on this occasion, these five items I suggested about legislature, about executive, about judiciary, and also about the societal behavior. Societal behavior, change in societal behavior also is equally important. Mere law, mere government alone cannot transform the country or the society. I just recall one small thing and conclude. When there was a discussion, in our country we have developed a system. Anything happening, bring a new law. New law. Hyderabad University, one law. Nirbhaya, one law. Now the latest is mob lynching, one law. There are enough laws. We have to implement it. That's the problem. So I remember, I am not against the new law. People may say, Vice President, do not want anti-lynching. It's a crime already under the law. So I remember in 2012, when this Nirbhaya Prakaran came, discussion was on, and people were saying, arguing for new law. And I stood up. I was not supposed to speak. I told Mr. Chairman, now I am the chairman. At that time, I was a member. So I took the permission of chairman. Mr. Chairman, I want to say just say few lines. I said, what is required is not a new bill. What is required is political will, administrative skill, and go for the kill of the social evil. That's what is required. These are all social evils. You must mobilize the society. Change the mindset. You have the great examples of reformists in Tamil Nadu. I need not take their names and all. But you know what is happening in certain parts even in Tamil Nadu also. Not only this government or that government, that's not the issue. We should not politicalize it also. So we have to create social awareness among the people and then set good examples by leaders. My dear friends, I thought here being in a historic city, in the company of such great intellectuals, we are making a good contribution to the cause of society and also on the completion of 2 years of my office as Vice President, I thought I should share some of my thoughts with the people of the country through you from Chennai today. That's why I have taken a little more time. Thank you very much for the support you have extended for the success of this program. I could see almost who is who from various fields of Chennai and also people coming from other areas also. Yesterday, I noticed one thing in the newspaper. This Article 370, now Home Minister has pirated it and you are all appreciating him for the historic this thing and all. I also feel now that bill is passed, now I can be free to speak. That's the need of the hour. It's a good thing. I was also really under tension, as Amit Bhai was saying, because as chairman, you have to conduct the house to see to it, and at the same time, the business is carried up. But you know, nowadays, what is happening and all. I don't want to remove the members, use force, like what happened on the Telangana, Andhra, this thing and all, closing the doors, stopping the Doordarshan, and then removing 30, 40 people. I was praying and I was thinking how to, because the bill, instead of going to Lok Sabha, it has come to Rajya Sabha. Because they seem to have decided we must first cross the hurdle in Rajya Sabha itself so that we can go to Lok Sabha and all. okay, government has got every right. So the bill came before me. I gave a serious thought. Then I was hoping. But luckily, members from all sides, they all spoke. There was a proper voting also. And there was division also. And then by two-thirds majority, 370 has been abrogated. And some people are saying, you know, suddenly all of these things and all. It's not sudden. I was surprised to read yesterday's Hindustan Times newspaper. Special status of Kashmir must end, insist MPs. This is 1964. Now we are in 2019. This happened in Parliament. All sides, Prakash Veer Shastri, independent member, he moved the bill. K. Hanumantayya, Congress, and also H.V. Kamath, and also Bhagwatja Ajad, former Chief Minister of Bihar, D.C. Sharma, Kashiram Gupta, Saroj Pandey, and then H.V. Kamath, Ram Manohar Lohia. Out of people, they all spoke about the bill, and the report says Shyamalal Saraf, Indrajit Malhotra, and G.D. Mengi from Kashmir, they all said the state has suffered enough, now the Article 370 must go. This is a 1964 discussion. So, and irrespective of parties, everybody supported that resolution at that time. But still, it could not happen. That's a different matter. What I am saying is, always we must remember the history. We must analyze what happened and what has not happened and then move forward. This 370 abrogation is in the interest of the nation. For its future, for its security, for its safety, I can say, as the Vice President, with considerable experience in public life, now that the Parliament has voted it also, we should all think in terms of national interest rather than party interest. National interest. 370 should not be treated as a political issue. It should be treated as a national issue that Kashmir is an integral part of India. Whatever problems are there, we should all stand by the people of Kashmir and assuage their feelings and see to it that steps are taken for restoring normalcy and for implementing developmental and welfare agenda at the earliest. I thought I should share some of these thoughts with you. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Nandri. Vanakkam.
Thank you very much, sir, for your precious words. As today's program